first time to the body. Pick up with thy Lord. Abide in him always. And feed on his word. Make friends of God's children. Help those who are weak. Forgetting in nothing. His blessing to teach. Take time to be holy. The world rushes on. Spend much time in secret with Jesus alone. By looking to Jesus, thy king thou shalt be. Thy friend in thy conduct, his likeness shall see. Take time to be holy. Let him be thy guide. And run not before him. Whatever betide, in joy or in sorrow, still follow thy Lord. And looking to Jesus, still trust in his word. Take time to be holy. Be calm in thy soul. Each thought and each temper beneath his control. Thus, led by his spirit, the fountains of love, thou shalt soon be fitted for service above. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ. Arise, Daniel. He was a man of holiness. He was a man of wisdom. I want to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ.
I want to be like Daniel.
Amen. To be like Daniel. He was a man of holiness. He was a man of wisdom. I want to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ. Daniel, be like Daniel. He was a man of faithfulness. He was full of courage. I want to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ.
I want to be like
Daniel. Want to be like Daniel. He was full of knowledge, a man of understanding. I want to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ.
I want to be like
Daniel. I want to be like Daniel.
I want to be like Daniel.
He was a man of courage. He was a man of faithfulness. I want to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ.
I want to be like
Daniel.
I want to be like
Daniel. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ.
I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ.
You need to be like Daniel. You need to be like Daniel. You need to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ.
I want to be like
Daniel, Daniel.
I want to be like
Daniel. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ. Close your eyes and pray that prayer. A man of holiness, full of wisdom. I want to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ. A man of courage, a man of faithfulness. I want to be like Daniel, to follow Jesus Christ. Name we pray. Almighty Father, we want to let us know, and the world all together, that the story of Daniel was a reality. You have repeated it in our generation. We praise you for that. This is mystery indeed. We are here to watch your mystery, to listen to your mystery. Take the glory in Jesus' name. Let souls of men and women be turned unto the Lord in Jesus' name. Let the sound of this message go to all churches in all the world, in Jesus' name. Let your spirit inspire every action here and direct us to honor Jesus. Thank you, divine. Worship you, Lord. Jesus' name we pray. We can be seated. The outline is with you. Jesus' message to the Methodist Church in mystery writing interpreted. Jesus' message to the Methodist Church in mystery writing interpreted. Let's go to page 6, where you will see the mystery writing. Page 6. Page 6, page 7, and page 8. The writing below are 6 pages from the 15 pages of what the Lord instructed Sister Bester S. Michael to write as a message to the Methodist Church. We have page 1, page 2, page 3, page 4. And then in page, we have page 5 and 6. When she comes up, she will tell you, she will show you the book. She wrote these things on in with her pen. Looking at this writing, do we see it as a child that wrote it? Examine it well. Is it the writing of a child? Is it the writing of a confused man? You look at the writing. Someone said a child cannot write this because it is written in order. It is written in a clean way. It is written in a straight line. Looking at it, a child cannot do it because a child cannot have consistency to do it. Another thing is, if they ask you to copy this writing, how will you be able to copy it? I'm sure you will take days learning the writing. That's why when our sister finished this writing, the Lord said, you can go and have your rest. It's okay. Go and lie down. Now, go back to page 1. I, Pastor Paul Rica, returned to Nigeria for my trip to Canada and the United States. I was told by my brethren that a member of Methodist Church, Sister Bester Michael, had an encounter with the Lord Jesus through near-death experience during their regional women conference held in United Methodist Church, Masaka, Nasarawa State, 11th to 14th May 2017. Sister Bester got completely restored and came with many messages from the Lord to individuals and to the Methodist Church. She demanded for a notebook and wrote illegible, unknown
an unreadable writing on it. According to her, the Lord Jesus told her in the encounter that no one in the world could read and make the meaning of the writing known except Pastor Paul Ricker. This incident appeared in Bible account of Daniel. Daniel chapter 5 verse 1 to 13. In the same hour came forth fingers of a man's hand and wrote over against the candlestick upon the plaster of the wall of the king's palace. And the king saw the part of the hand that wrote. Then the king's countenance was changed, and his thoughts troubled him, so that the joints of his loins were loosed, and his knees smote one against another. The king cried aloud to bring in the astrologers, the Chaldeans, and the soothsayers. And the king spake and said to the wise men of Babylon, "Whosoever shall read this writing and show me the interpretation thereof shall be clothed with scarlet and have a chain of gold about his neck and shall be the tenth ruler in the kingdom." Then came in all the king's wise men, but they could not read the writing, nor make known to the king the interpretation thereof. Now the queen, by reason of the weight of the king and his lords, came into the banquet house. And the queen spake and said, "O king, live forever. Let not thy thoughts trouble thee, nor let thy countenance be changed. There is a man in thy kingdom, in whom is the spirit of the holy gods. And in the days of thy father, light and understanding and wisdom, like the wisdom of the gods, was found in him, whom the king Nebuchadnezzar, thy father, the king, I say, thy father, made master of the magicians, astrologers, Chaldeans, and soothsayers. For as much as an excellent spirit and knowledge and understanding, interpreting of dreams and showing of hard sentences and dissolving of doubts were found in the same Daniel, whom the king named Belteshazzar. Now let Daniel be called, and he will show the interpretation." Then was Daniel brought in before the king. And the king spake and said unto Daniel, "Art thou that Daniel, which art of the children of the captivity of Judah, whom the king, my father, brought out of Jewry? When I heard of this, I wondered how this could be done by me." Apart from the Daniel's interpretation in scripture over the writing of Belshazzar, I had never heard anything of that nature again. I thought within myself, if God wanted to do such wonders through me, I would watch how it would come up. I declared fasting and prayer with my leaders the next day, being Tuesday, the 23rd of May, 2017, to hear what God would say about this issue, even as Daniel did. In Daniel chapter 2, verse 17 to verse 23. "Then Daniel went to his house and made the thing known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, that they would desire mercies of the God of heaven concerning this secret. that Daniel and his fellows should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his, and he changeth the times and the seasons. He removeth kings and setteth up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise, and knowledge to them that know understanding. He revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth with him. I thank thee. Let's read verse 23 together. I thank thee and praise thee, O thou God of my fathers, who has given me wisdom and might, and has made known unto me now what we desire of thee. For thou hast now made known unto us the king's matter. Give a clap offering to Jesus. Amen. At this time, we are going to invite Pastor Alpha Jesmere Hockey, the host pastor of the conference, the pastor of United Methodist Church, Uton Massacre, Nasarawa State.
Praise the Lord. Let me use my brother Tamloji from Bochi, who says you are Amen is not born again. Praise the Lord. I've been doing it in my church. So thank God for today. I'm honored to be here. Sir, God of Holiness Revival Movement is real. Amen. You don't know what this word just caused in your life, because right now, that word that I just uttered has delivered many souls here. Because the word of God said, we overcome by the words of our testimonies. My name is Pastor Alpha Jesmere Hockey. I'm here with my wife and some of my church members. We are witness of what has just happened. Let me take you back. The reason why I say the God of Holiness Revival Movement Worldwide is real is because of my dressing like this. This is a complete dressing of a United Methodist Church priest. When the issue of Revival Holiness Movement came to us in Kaduna, you know we are theologians. We dig issues. We evaluate issues. We start with the issue of earrings and whatever. We began to search the scripture, bringing the scripture that God said that I have made this for you. I said, Mba, we will not accept this. When Jesus started doing his work, because yesterday our daddy said, it is God's movement. So you don't need to struggle.
As far as you believe in the word,
you don't need to struggle. I was hiding this testimony for a long time, but today God has arrested me. I was praying to God, only one prayer. God, let there be divine encounter, divine change in our church. And praise God, it has happened. Amen. I'm here to testify what God has done for me and my family. When I started coming close to Holiness Revival Movement worldwide, the persecution started. I was due for my second ordination as an elder. I went for the interview. They are all aware that we all join the Holiness Revival Movement. We were afraid to come out boldly and show ourselves that we are deeply members, but a hidden members, causing a lot of revival in our church. I went for my interview. The interview was to last for 15 to 20 minutes. The questions that we are supposed to ask were not the question that we are asking. The first question is, we hear that you have bring another doctrine in our church. I say, no, it is not a new doctrine, but the doctrine is rooted from the word of God. The doctrine is no other doctrine, but doctrine that is talking about holiness, righteousness, and truth. They say, but we all know this, not yet, but we deviate from it, sir. Do you want to teach me the Bible? I said, no, I don't want to teach you, but I want you to come back and remember where we are first short. My interview was supposed to last for 15 to 20 minutes, but it lasted for 2 hours. At the end of it, I was denied the ordination. Let's see who will stand for you. When I come back, I decided to leave the church and start my own church. But the Holy Spirit said, no, this is not the time. They now said, we have to transfer Pastor Alpha from Kaduna to Masaka. If not, he will open his church and he will take all our members. They transferred me from Kaduna to Masaka. I don't know that God is drawing me close to where I will meet the rules. Amen. You know, devil is not wise. If at all, devil will know that my coming to Masaka will cause a revival in our entire church, he will not allow me to come to Masaka. Because he drew me and bring me close to Daddy Porika, very close. You don't know, I'm very happy for the first time I shake his hand. Since for that time, revival has started taking place. The next year, they called me. Have you applied for ordination? I said, no, sir. Why? I said, because I'm still with that movement. I won't apply. They say, no, we are all one. I said, no, please, sir, we are not one. They said, apply. I said, I will not apply. They were begging me to apply. That is why I asked for permission. I said, sir, I have to testify. At the end of it, they called me. They ordained me as a reverend in the United Methodist Church. I own this testimony for this church. This movement, I have to come and testify. And to tell you, if really you are a member of this movement, The God of this movement never fails. You did not hear what I said. I said the God of this movement never fails. No matter the trial and persecution, one day you will give a testimony. We are safe. Our church is safe. Now to what happened. It's all written in this pamphlet. I was the guest speaker of the convention in Massacre. I'm also the host pastor. On the 11th to 14th of May, when the district woman leader came to me, that, sir, we want you to be the guest speaker of this program. I said, no. Why? I said, no reason. She now went to Area 1 to meet my senior pastor. We want him to be the guest speaker, but he refused. He said, no problem, I will call him. He said, Pastor Alpha, I said, sir, I order you to be the guest speaker of the convention. I said, sir, your wish is my command. I don't know that God is planning something to do in that convention. On the 11th of May, the convention started. Before the convention even started, I was not on myself. I was very weak. My wife was asking me, what is the problem? I said, the fever has started again. I don't know that it is the work of God to keep me calm, to keep me close for the tax ahead. The women from Kaduna were on their way coming. He started with the wife of our pastor, our sister, Mrs. Bester Michael. She also were feeling the same. Immediately they arrived at the church. There was a situation on ground. She was very sick. We don't know that it is a plan of God. Sometimes when the presence of God comes to you, if you are not in the system fully, you won't understand. We just take it as something very strange. I went to the church and met her. Sister, what is happening? I asked the woman there, have you prayed? They say, yes, we have prayed. You pray and she's not okay, you stop the prayers. Bring her in. Then I'll bring her in. I lay my hand upon her. I ask God to heal her. And immediately, there was a bit calm. She calmed down. We went to the church fully for the program. The topic was shine as light in this world. You know, we Methodists, we are used to that. In all of our programs, hardly to see something holy there. For those that know the United Methodist Church, hardly to see anything holy there. I wanted to go inside the church. The Spirit now ministered to me that I should go back. I went back to my room. The Lord changed the topic. I have one of my daughter. The first time I visited Kwali in ministers' conference, I filled the daughter with writings. Something that I've never done in my life. Sometimes if I went to a program, I would just be sleeping because that is nothing new. But in Kwali, there are a lot of new things. A lot of new things. Sir, I use some of your messages to cause revival in many churches. God has given you and you gave it back to us. And this is one of the aims
of all the holiness revival movements seated here and worldwide, the more you have something new that has to do with the coming of Jesus and the way we live our life, you have to take it to somebody. I'm a secret member of this movement, but today I make myself available for this movement. Some of my members are members of this movement. Before you know, the entire church will be covered with this member of this movement. God changed the topic. He said, speak on holy character in a holy place. I said, I remember this message now, and it's the message that transformed my life. Because anything you will do, if there is no holiness, you will not make it. I called my senior pastor and said, God has changed the topic. He said, just go ahead. Do what the Lord is leading you to do. I started with a story of Hannah, how she dedicated herself in Shiloh. I speak to the people and said, if you want God to visit us in this convention, you must make yourself holy. Because God cannot come into a camp that is dirty. And this church is not a camp. Our body is the camp that Jesus will visit. The Spirit is doing His work. We consecrated ourselves. We make ourselves holy. We keep ourselves holy, and we keep the environment holy. After the message, the Holy Spirit whispered to me that the Master will be visiting this convention. Make the people know about the visitation, and they should prepare themselves because the Master will be coming. I said to all my brothers and sisters, there is a message. Jesus will visit this convention. You know, we have the orthodox mind and the orthodox character. This testimony that I'm giving, I'm telling you, will transform the life of more than 500 clergymen in our United Methodist Church. Hallelujah. The women were all ready for the visitation, because the message that was being preached, a lot of people that visited that confession testified, no confession ever be powerful like this convention. Because most of the convention, I believe, we're organizing it ignorantly. But now that the presence of God, of holiness revival movement, is working in some of us, He helps us to organize that program in the manner that the Master will come Himself. I declare 6 hours prayer and fasting. That's on Saturday morning. From Saturday, from 6 o'clock to 12 o'clock. Immediately after the fasting, we start praying. The Holy Spirit ministered to me that I should lay my hand on the people there. I started laying my hand on people. People were experiencing a kind of atmosphere they have never experienced in their life. The entire place, people bursted with tears. Something that I've never witnessed in the United Methodist Church. You to preach for United Methodist Church member to cry is a lie. That was the first conversion that women were crying. Some of them were rolling on the floor. I lay my hand on Sister Besta. The Holy Spirit touched her. And that is how He started. On Saturday evening, There was a meeting, so the convention, we did not have much time to preach. Close to 11 to 12 or so, Jesus now started preparing the ground. The angels started preparing the ground for the coming of the Master. The angels now visited Sister Bester. She will testify that with herself, that we have come to take you home. And to God be the glory, this is what we have been praying for a long time, that let revival come to our church. Twelve midnight, I went into my room to sleep. A woman come and called me. That is situation, no, is Mommy Bester. I say, Mommy Bester again. What is the problem? We don't know that the angels are preparing her for the coming, because we find it very difficult to control her. When he started, I just go straight to the room. I was told by one of my professors of theology that we have two spirits. One can be Holy Spirit and one can be evil spirit. And he teaches us how to do the prayer. If you go lay your hand and say, if the spirit is from God, God continue, let your will be done. If the spirit is from the devil, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Sometimes if you are not careful, you even rebuke the spirit, the Holy Spirit there, you don't know, with your carnal understanding. I just went there. I began to fire prayer, you know. And now lay my heart, oh Sister Bester. Bester, I rebuke this spirit, it's from the devil. The Holy Spirit says, hey, who are you? Stop it. I now park myself outside. Because something that has to do with God. Ha! Who are you to fall in the hands of God? I say, God, let your will be done. I went out. I sat down. I was praying outside. I say, Tor. I speak in Hausa. Maybe some of you will know here Hausa. I say, Tor, Ubangiji, Yofa Munshigawuku. Today, we are in trouble. Amen. After some minutes, I asked the pastor to go in, please. Go and pray for her. For me, the spirit has rebuked me. That is not an evil spirit. So you go. Maybe you will have the same spirit, the same talk. He went there. Thank God. God used him to speak to her, and she know that it's God that sent him to her. She now calmed down. She starts giving some messages, a lot of messages. She called me and gave me my message. She gave a message to the women leaders. She gave a message to the elders. She gave a message to the entire church. The one that God has sealed it, that no one should understand the written, is the one of the writings. Unreadable writings. She demanded for a written materials. If you see the way she's begging to have these written materials, writing materials, she were begging. Thank God at last they gave her. She were writing unreadable. I tried to come and glance to see what she's writing. Oh my God, nobody will understand that writing. I said, she's my junior in seminary. She's supposed to write well. But what is the problem? She's not writing well. It is a mystery. She finished the writing. Then she said, Lord, you say I should take it to Pastor Daddy Porika. He is the only person on this earth that will read and interpret. I said, Tom.
Immediately I hear that the Porika name, I started withdrawing myself. That is the truth. As I was trying to withdraw,
she said, but I don't know him. He said, you say Pastor Alpha will take me to Daddy Forika. I said my name again.
I don't want to be part and parcel of it because I know what I will pass through with my church. I'm trying to dodge. Then the Holy Spirit ministered to me, don't worry. I've already made the arrangement before today. And I said, oh, so this is the reason why I was being transferred from Kaduna to Masaka. And the first day I visited Kwali, I know the place. If you're ready, let's go. That very Saturday night, we have, to me in person, I have never experienced a kind of atmosphere like that in my life. Because the night was a different night, a very different night. I went to my room around 2 a.m. Jesus visited me in my room and took me to the church. I've told you, I will visit this convention. We went into the church. He will come and touch this woman, touch that woman. He make himself known to them. They were happy to see Jesus face to face in that revelation. On Sunday service, we now worship and praise God. After the message, I wanted to start prayer as the Spirit is leading me. Now say, okay, let's bring our sister in. She starts testifying the messages that God gave her. For us to confirm it, you know, we, the Methodist Church, we are people of method. Everything has to do thank God, thank you for that correction. So we ask, we pray to God that let there be confirmation of this revelation from some of the members. And now ask question. Something happened yesterday night. How many people noticed what happened? How many people feel the visitation of the Lord Jesus Christ in this church? A lot of women wave their hand. After she finished testifying on some minutes that we gave her, we start praying. The church bursted in tears. Everybody was in tears. She will come to you and tell you this is what God said concerning you. It was a miracle Sunday. We pray to God. We know that there will be a series of persecution, but we trust God that called us, God that manifests himself. He will show us the way forward. My senior pastor were present with us. He took the message very seriously. But I'm sorry, we are noticing it's compromised somewhere. But for us, we are not ready to compromise. We went to Kwali to meet Daddy. After we tell him everything that happened, he started interpreting the unreadable writings. One after the other, the word that is saying is true. I'm a pastor of the United Methodist Church. Every bit of the translated, interpreted word there is true.
He gave us a copy. We now organize a district meeting to carry the readings to our district headquarters. And now ask, what are we going to do? The scene of the United Methodist Church has reached heaven. Yes. You will not understand what I'm saying. My brother from Bochi yesterday said, we were like them at the other sites before. We know ourselves. It's true. Every interpreted word that you will see here concerning the Methodist Church is true. The issue of pride. If you come to dancing and singing, we will dance as if the roof will went off. We don't know that God is not hearing us. We don't know. We shed tears concerning this revelation. Later on, the Spirit said, why are you shedding tears? It's what you have been praying for, that let revival come to the United Methodist Church. Some people said, they come out and testified, this issue of this written, they call it this written, this writing, but to us, it's not just a writing. I said, you call it just a writing. Why is that there is no pastor in the United Methodist Church that can interpret? Why that there is no pastor in other churches that can read and interpret, except in the Holiness Revival Movement? So, shall we continue to our sinful life in the name of we are serving God? For us, we are no part of it. We just ended the meeting without any reasonable something that we carry to our various churches, because some people come from Kaduna, Mina, and we here in Masaka. Immediately we come back to Masaka on Sunday after the service. I sat with my entire members. We read the message. The interpreted message we read. Somebody shouted, Jesus, we are finished. And the problem is not from our members. The genesis of the problem is for us, from us, we the pastors. From the pastors, the bishop, there was an election of bishop in our church. The church now is divided into two. The issue of homosexual and lesbianism. Our church are voting in order that the system of lesbianism and homosexuality should be legal in our church. The issue of fornication and adultery in our church. That one is on a simple thing now. That reached at the point that some youth are sleeping with girls in the church. In the name of their walking in the church. What I'm telling you here, I will stand before God and testify. If I'm lying, I'm standing in the house of God that never fails. Every bit of the message in this book is true. But in our church in Masaka, we declare 3 days prayer and fasting that God should have mercy upon us. And the message said, the reformation, the revival, will start from the church of Masaka.
and privilege to stand in this place to testify what God has done for us. The last word that Jesus speak is that the end of the age is at hand. And yesterday our daddy said we are the last generation. He now confirmed what Jesus said. Every bit of his word has a confirmation. I have a sister, my treasurer, in our church that would like her to please come here. She's there as a witness. Time may not permit us to call some of our brethren that are here to speak what they see with their eyes. The reformation has started in our church. To God be the glory. From today, I don't have chapter O, but I want to announce to this church that I'm a full member of this movement from today. And my chapter is Masaka chapter. Thank you, sir.
Praise the Lord. Brethren, praise the Lord. Amen. My name is Sister Nana Musa Daniel. I am in Masaka chapter and Anguan Soldier Unit. I'm also a member of the United Methodist Church where this mystery reading happened. Though I am not the member of the women conference, I am not the member of, we used to call them Martin Zumunta, I am not among them. So I did not participate fully in the program. But I just come there to witness in the Bible study competition that they did. After the Bible study, it was music competition, so I left. I did not participate fully. But the following day on Sunday when I came to church, as they were testifying what happened during the conference, I really regret it because they testified that Jesus was present in that conference. Praise the Lord. And I also want to testify about my pastor when he visited Kwali for the first time. When he came back, we really see changes the way he preached. Though he was a good preacher, but the spirit that is working in him after he came back from Kwali is different. Praise the Lord. Because when he started preaching, he would be preaching and be crying. Sometimes he would lie down on the altar crying because of the anointing that he came back from it, from Kwali. And it transformed many people. So, about my mommy Vesta's testimony, when she was sharing the testimony on Sunday, I was there. The way the church responds, people were weeping. I myself, I wept, I cried, and I started speaking in tongues. I spoke in tongues that day very well. We were jubilating because some of us that are already Holiness Revival members, we are just happy because of that visitation. After I wept, I cried, I prayed, and I spoke in tongues. When I was free, I came outside to ease myself. One of the brother that is in Holiness Revival Movement came out. We are jubilating outside because of what the Lord has done in our church. Because we were praying always for God to visit the church. And we thank him for his wonderful deed that he did in our church. We pray that other branches all over the world will still accept the message in the mighty name of Jesus. Praise the Lord. So we really thank God. The way that day that she spoke, she started giving the message for individual people that God send her to them. Some of them accepted it. At last day, they kneeled down and asked for forgiveness. But some of them rejected it. We pray that those that did not accept it, God will touch their heart so that they will repent in Jesus' name. And the way you will feel the presence of the Holy Spirit that day in the church, because I saw women weeping. I saw men weeping. I myself wept. And my own is the weeping of joy because of the visitation that the Lord has visited the United Methodist Church. One of the things that make me happy, she said, God will bring revival in United Methodist Church, and it will start from UMC and Massacre. We really thank God for His mercy upon our life, that He chose us among His people, that He wants to prepare us so that this heavenly race, we will also join it in Jesus' name. We pray that God will see us through, that we will not compromise. At the end, we will go and meet there in heaven in Jesus' name. Thank you very much.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now, as you sit down, we are going to invite our beloved sister, Bester Michael, who is going to come as the main person, the visioner, to tell us how it went with her from the Lord. The Lord be with her in Jesus' name.
What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. You can be seated. Praise the Lord. Somebody praise the living God. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, the Most High God, I am that I am, omnipotent, omnipresent God. You are today, yesterday, forevermore. You remain the same, you remain our God. Daddy, we are here before the throne of grace. We are not worthy to come before you. But Lord, you choose us to be among the living ones today. Lord, we are saying thank you. Daddy, we appreciate you. I am here before your people empty-handed. But Lord, I know you are here. My Father, present yourself. Present yourself. Daddy, I believe you that you have started this journey, you will end it. Baba, I glorify your name. I give you all thy praise. For in Jesus' mighty name I have prayed. Amen. Praise the Lord. First of all, I want to appreciate God for his kindness. I want to appreciate him for all that he has been doing in my life. Honestly, I am not worthy. I am not worthy. But I give God the glory. I give God the glory. And I believe God is here. I believe he will touch the heart that you want to touch. But until you open your heart, I believe God will do it. First of all, as our daddy Rika interprets this message, our God is a living God. The God of holiness is a true God. I want to appreciate him for his kindness over my life. Before I give you this testimony, as it was written on 11-14, that is where I have an encounter with Jesus. On the 6th May 2017, I had a dream. And in this dream, we are in a gathering with some women. We are there with our problems to receive healing, to receive all that has been provided for us at that program. As we went there, in the program, in the dream, I saw many pastors in the dream. By then, I saw one lady. They brought her for deliverance. As the lady came, they called one pastor to deliver her. As the pastor saw the lady saw the pastor and said, "This pastor, he will not deliver me. He cannot deliver me because the thing that he carries in his life, in him, he will not deliver him. I know everything about him." So by then, God took my attention from them. I saw devil by himself. He came to my side and carried me at his back. As he carried me at his back, he's telling to people that, "You see this woman? She is my servant before. But now, I will drop her down. She is no more my candidate again. Praise the Lord." As the devil dropped me down, then God took my attention from there. I saw one angle and many pastors there. Then I saw three pastors. I don't know them. The angel of God covered them like this. He said, "These are my people. Nothing will touch them. Nothing will harm them." Then I said, "Wow, what is happening?" I saw one angel. God is sharing blessings to people. I tell to some women, "Let us go there so that we will receive our blessings." Some, their mind is not settled. They did not prepare their heart. Then I say, I will go there. And I know if I go there, I will not come back empty-handed until I receive my blessings. As I reached there, they were just like a bit of far away from me. Then I saw light. God is dividing blessings for them. Then I say, "Lord, I did not reach there. But those people that you are giving them blessings, I will tap it from their own. As I said, Lord, I will not leave this garden until you bless me. And the reason why I go there, I want God to bless me with the fruit of womb. That's my abundance, so praise the Lord. Then, as I say, I tap it from their own. I feel my womb is opening, is opening, is opening in the dream. Then I say, wow, I started praising God. I started praising God. I started praising God. Then I wake up. As I wake up, I say, wow, what is the meaning of this dream? Lord, interpret it to me. So it means you answered my prayer. Let me just fast and seek your face. On that sixth, that's on Saturday, then I wake up. As I wake up, I start fasting. I did not inform my husband, this is the dream that I have. I did not tell him anything. Then I started fasting. On the sixth, on the seventh, eighth, nine, ten, 11, that's the day that we will come to Masaka for that gathering. To me, if I come to that garden, I will finish the remaining fasting there. So, on that 11, we have already prepared. We have finished everything. My husband escorted me. He prayed for us. Nothing. I am well. Nothing is wrong with me. I am healthy. Nothing is wrong with me. So, on our way going, as we entered Abuja, it was raining, very, very heavy rain. So we locked all the windows. As we locked the windows, I started feeling my breath is seasoning. My breath is seasoning. It will just be up and down, up and down. I say, wow, what is happening with me, Lord? What is happening? Within me, I started praying, asking for mercy. I said, God, I don't know. I have never experienced this kind of thing in my life, but I don't know. If this day will be the end of my life, Lord, have mercy on me. And my prayers, I don't want to miss heaven. That's what I started praying. As we go on, this my hand, this side, like I am paralyzed. I don't know. Some women are asking me, Mom, see what is happening? I say, no, Onima Bansaniba. They still ask me, are you well? But within me, something is telling me, prepare your heart, you are going. As I heard that voice, I say, God, I am not afraid of death. That's the plain truth. But my prayers always, Lord, I don't want to miss heaven. I don't want to miss heaven. That's my prayer. As we nearly entered to Masaka, I lose my strength. As I lose it, I just tell them that I want to ease myself. So I call one woman. I tell her that, hold my hand. Help me so that I will go and ease myself. As I went, my hand, like, it's shaking, my body is shaking. I say, wow, what is happening? I don't know. As we finish, we just enter. In the car still, my breath is up and down, up and down, up and down. I say, oh God, have mercy. I'm just pleading for mercy. I'm just pleading for mercy. As we nearly entered Masaka, I nearly fainted in the car. They don't know. I tell them, no, I have never experienced
in my life. The only thing I ask in my servant that they should go and they should fetch my beef. They may drink it. So they ask me now, what do we do? Then I say they should pray for me. As they are praying, I started also asking for mercy, asking for mercy, asking for mercy. Then daddy came in.
Then daddy came in. They called daddy. Then I heard him. Why can't you pray? They say, daddy, we have prayed. Then he say, huh, you don't have faith? They keep quiet. Then he say, carry her inside. As they carry me inside, he prays. I just fell asleep. That night, I did not attend the program on that 11th. That's on Thursday. On Friday, we attended the program. We finished it successfully. As he had said it, he called for altar call. He called for those that they are sick. To me, this seasoning of breathing, I'm feeling like I'm just going home. I don't know, I just come out. As he prayed, he lay hands on me. As he lay hands on me, I nearly fell down. They hold me. As we finished for that program successfully that Friday, on Saturday, I attended the morning program. We are having quiz program. And song competition. So we finished the quiz, remaining song competition. Still, my breath started again. I say, wow, I know this journey, I will not end it. I started praying. I just attended the competition. I don't want to enter, but I must enter, because if I did not enter the sales competition, the remaining women, they will feel weak. I just speak courage. I attend the competition. As we finish, after finishing it, after around 6 to 7, then we are having a meeting, like a district meeting. As the women coordinator called us, as she called in the meeting, by then we are there, all of us, we are there. I did not say anything on that meeting that they called for. I just gave one advice. That advice I stopped. I did not talk again on that Saturday. So by then, we closed for the meeting. It's after 10. As we come back, I and the remaining pastor's wife, we are eating together. As I carry the food, 1, 2, 3, the food hung on my neck. I did not swallow the food did not come out. I say, wow, the breath ceased. They don't know what is happening with me. I just wake up, I wash my hands, and then I lie down. One person away from Mina, she's not here. That woman, she's just washing at me. Any movement, she's just looking at me. Then she say, ah, Mama Kaduna, what is happening? I tell her that, no, this journey, I will not end it. So as I tell her like this, she say, ah, what is happening? I say, no, I know what I am passing through. You will not know what I am passing through. Then after then, I call two of them. She and Mama Masaka, the wife of Pastor Alpha. I say, okay, please. Is that any clinic nearby? So that let us go and check my BP. As they hold, I don't have strength. I lose my strength. They hold me. On our way going, we reach the chemist to explain to the attendants I can't see. Then I tell them that they should tell the attendants this is what I am passing through. So as they tell him, the attendants test my BP. It was 143.91. It means the BP is a little bit high. So he gave us two drugs. On our way coming, I tell him that they should find Okada. My feet will not carry me again because I lose my strength. My body is no longer my body. Then I'm telling them that, no, you will not know what I am passing through. I know what I am passing through inside me. And within me, my spirit is telling me, prepare. I say, wow, this journey is true. As we come back, Mama Masaka, she prayed on the medicine. Then I took the medicine. As I took the medicine, I just lie down. Within 11 to 12, by then the journey started. I had it deep within me that you will go. The only thing that you do now, call your husband and ask for forgiveness. I say, wow, it's true. Then, by then I have already prepared my heart because I know I am going. That's the plain truth. And in 12 midnight, I pick my phone, I call that woman and the wife pastor of Nina. I say, please help me. I want to go to toilet because I don't want to talk in the presence of the remaining pastor's wife because they will be afraid. So as we enter the toilet, the angels of God are there with me. I say, wow, the journey is real. So by then, I pick my phone, I call my husband. I say, Daddy, I don't know. In this journey, wherever I have sinned against you, whether I knew it or I don't know it, please, I am asking for forgiveness. Please forgive me. If I do something wrong for you, forgive me. Then he said, Mommy, why are you speaking like this? I said, no, Daddy, you will not understand. Because by then the angels are there with me, waiting for me. Praise the Lord. My dear brothers and sisters, wherever you are, God is watching you. You cannot run away from death. You can't. Then as I call him, he said, okay, I don't know, but me too. If I wrong you, please, my dear, forgive me. I said, Daddy, I have forgiven you forever and ever. By the way, you did not do anything to me. I have forgiven you. Then the woman, she's asking me, why am I speaking like this? I say, no, you will not know. Can't you see the angels are waiting for me to go? She too, she started, she has been suffering in sorrow. Praise the Lord. So she said, okay, let's go back in. As we go back in, I slept. My eyes, just my attention is there. That's the plain truth. Because I have already prepared my heart. So I still feel the Holy Spirit is telling me, preach to the remaining pastor's wife. I started preaching for them. In my preaching, I tell them that they should be patient. They should have the heart of forgiveness. They should have the heart of forgiveness. In any circumstances, in any situation, in any trial, they should just have the heart of forgiveness. I started preaching for them. My tongue has changed. My words have changed. Like if you want to go somewhere, just it's a word that I'm telling them bye-bye to the world. I started asking them for forgiveness. If I wrong you, please have mercy on me and forgive me. Then, by then, I lie down like this. My eyes were closed. I am preaching for them. Then deeply, my ears, like something blocked my ears like this. I had this voice, very deep. I asked you, no ears. As I had this deep voice, I don't have strength. Then I wake up with strength. I didn't need more ears, but I will send you back with messages. Then I say, wow. Another walk again. I started saying, no, I can't do. No, I will not fit. No, I can't do. But Lord said, I will send you back with messages. Then I said, wow. By then, I started praising God. We that we are in the room, we started giving God praise. My dear brothers, God needs praise. God needs praise. We started praising Him, giving Him thanks. We are thanking Him, thanking Him, thanking Him. So by then, God says, great revival is coming upon UMCN. Then I say, wow, upon UMCN again? So God, you mean you will send me to my church? Then I started denying. I said, no, I can't. No, who am I, by the way? I started telling God that I can't fit. I can't fit. God said, no, I must send you back to them. I don't have nothing to do. I just kneel down. I am asking God. By then, God opened my eyes. As He opened my eyes, I saw my husband. Because I have already said bye-bye to him. So God opened my eyes. As God opened my eyes, I saw my husband. He's crying that night. Crying. Bitterly crying. He's crying bitterly. And in his crying, he vowed to God. He said, God, why will you take my wife home now? In his crying. Why will you take my wife home now? I love my wife. I love my wife. I love my wife seriously with all of my heart. Then he said, God, if you take my wife home now, I will never remarry again. I will not remarry again. And if I did not remarry again, it will affect your ministry. Then I said, wow, that's why God says, I will send back your wife and I will give her messages to the church and to the individual people. Praise the Lord. From there, God started giving me messages. He asked me to find a writing material. The women that were together, I said, please, you should help me with writing materials. They refused to give me the writing materials. I said, God is here. He wants me to write. Give me writing materials. They refused. Then God started giving me messages to them. Some women that we are together, if he gave me the message, I will meet you and pass the message. If he gives me, I will meet you and pass the message. That's how we started. Then by then, I called Pastor Alpha. At the end, God gave me message to him. I said, where is Baba Alpha? Come, this is your message. As he come, I gave him his own message. As he started praying, as he explained it to you, he felt it within him. Then he left me. As he left me, I started altering words, giving messages to people because they refused to give me writing material. Then by then, I saw Pastor Absalom is coming. As he entered the room, as I saw him, I know he was sent by God. As I'm just seeing him, I knew it. Then I said, Daddy, so God sent you to come and calm me. Okay, you are welcome. Then I knelt down before him because that is what God gave me to do. I knelt down before him. Then I'm just listening to him. By then, God started giving me messages about pulpit. He said, pulpit is a holy place. It's a holy place. The pulpit is for the pastors that they were sitting here. They are my servants. I am the one who called them. They are my servants. But as of now, our churches, we neglect the pulpit. We defile the pulpit. A pastor will go out and drunk and sleep with a woman and lie and fornicate and do some wrong things before God. And tomorrow he will come and climb the pulpit saying, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. God says, no. He rejected. Then by then God says, we should respect our pastors. When we are respecting them, we are respecting him. Praise the Lord. Because he says, they are his workers. He is the one who called them. By then, I still ask them for writing material. They refused to give me. Then, the pastor said, Mommy, I saw now you are sweating. Just go outside so that you will rest small. I said, okay, Daddy, I will go outside. As I went outside, by then, I tied wrapper. I just tied wrapper with one small vase like this. No shape for my body. As we went out, they gave me seat. As I sat down, then the voice of the Lord started ministering to me. I should ask them that they should give me writing material. They refused. By then, Lord is there. We are together with him. He is there. By then, I feel ashamed of myself. He said, my daughter, find shape so that you will cover your nakedness. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Then, from there, I feel ashamed of myself before God. That's the plain truth. I feel ashamed of myself. I ask them, I say, please, find shade for me. You should give me shade. They find shade and they give me. So by then, he says, our body is only for our husband. God doesn't want to see our nakedness. He don't. But we women, we fail it. So by then, as I'm still asking them for the writing material, they gave me, God gave me message to women. He teach me how we respect our husband. He said, when you respect your husband, you are respecting him. If you carry food, kneel down in humbleness. That is seafood. He teach me how we greet our husband. Immediately he taught me, I would do the practical for them. That's what God wanted us to do. But we women, we fail. We fail it. So by then, there is one woman, as I started asking them for the writing material, they refused to get me. The wife of Pastor Alpha, she's there nearest me. God asked me, I should tell her that, let her carry the writing materials to give me. She refused. I asked her, she refused. Then God said, I should hold her here. She's too stubborn. I hold her here. I said, God says, you are too stubborn. So you don't want to get him the writing materials. Praise the Lord. I hold her ears. I tell her what God tells me. By then, there is one woman. Her name is Mary Mela from Kaduna. As she saw, I was desperate to get the writing materials. I don't know where she get the writing materials. She just wake up out and bring the writing materials for me. As she bring it, then God says, take the blessing of this woman that she refused to give you the writing material. Give it to this woman. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So, I say, you see what you have done? You missed it. And then, take the blessing. I say, Mary Mela, God says, you are blessed. Then I bless her. So, by then, as they gave me the writing material, God says, my daughter, you will write. I say, wow, how will I write? I don't know how to write. I know I passed through school, but I'm not good in speaking. I'm not good in writing. How will I write? To my own thought, I thought I would write in English or in Hausa. Then he said, no, you will write. I said, wow. Okay. He said, hold your pen. As I hold my pen, my hand started writing. He is giving me the messages. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. So he started giving me the messages. He gave me message about tithe. He said tithe is for priest. Tithe is for priest. That's what God gave me. After that, he gave me message about jewelry, trousers, high heels, all the attachments. God says, I hate them. I hate them. I hate them with bitter heart. Praise the Lord. If you heard the voice of God, oh my dear sister, God hates all those things with bitter heart. I hate them. Praise the Lord. So by then, I started writing. My hand, I'm just writing without stopping. Writing, I'm just writing. I said, which kind of writing? Before I start the writing, because I am wondering, he said, you will write. Then I said, I don't know how to write. How will I start it? He said, you will write. Hold your pen. As I hold the pen, that's where I started writing. I am saying this in my mouth, some I'll just keep quiet. The one that I don't know, I'll just keep quiet. The one that he gave me, I'll be writing them, I am altering them. But the remaining ones, I don't know, I'll just keep quiet. I'll just continue writing. Then, by then God says, my daughter, I choose you things, but for the worldly things, things of the world deviate you from me. But now I am back again to use you. Praise the Lord. Our God is a promise God. When God promised you, He will fulfill it. Praise the Lord. So, as I heard this voice, I say, yes, Lord. I felt it deep within me. I say, yes, I knew it. I have lived your way. Then he says, my daughter, tomorrow, take this writing to Paul Rica. Praise the Lord. God knows you with your name. God knows you. I started wondering within me. I said, Lord, I don't know this man. He said, take it. I will go before you. Before you go, I will be there before you. Then I said, Lord, I thank you. Praise the Lord. He said, take it to Porica. He is my servant. I said, God, I give you all the glory. So, by then, the right kind of right that I write, I was tired. I was tired. Then he said, my daughter, go and sleep. I will visit you in the morning. I said, wow. Because I asked him, God, you say I should take this writing to Porica. By the way, I don't know him. I don't know the man. How will I do? He said, my daughter, go and rest. Tomorrow morning, I will visit you and I will show you the person that will take you to him. Praise the Lord. As I go back, I did not sleep. I'm just waiting as he promised me. He said, you will come back this morning. On that morning, I did not sleep. Sleep did not carry me. We are just talking with God by then. He will talk to me. I will give him answer. I will ask him. He will give me answer. But still, I'm still complaining. I say, God, this work that you gave me to give your people in the church, the work is too heavy for my head. By the way, I am the smallest among the smallest. How will I do? How will I start it? He said, I am the one who sent you. So my daughter raised. In the morning, I called Pastor Alpha. I said, so, Daddy, the Lord said he will visit me this morning, and honestly, our God is faithful. Our God is faithful. As I called him, I said, he said that I should take this writing to Baba Porica, but I don't know him. Yes, I should take the writing to Baba Porica because he is the only person that would interpret this writing. I said, so, I don't know him. What will I do now? He said, no problem. No problem. God will make a way. So our daddy, his name is written. I'm telling you, he's written. God knows him. God knows him. Hold this movement. Hold it. Hold it. Hold it. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. If you miss heaven, that one is your own cup of tea. Praise the Lord. Don't miss heaven. So by then in the morning, as I share it with our daddy, Pastor Alpha, then he said, no problem, we will see him. By God's grace, we will see him. I said, okay. So in the morning still, God visited me on that morning. He said, I will visit the program on that Sunday. I will be there. I will do wonders and wonders and wonders. And God did it. Praise the Lord. In the morning, if I just sleep, like sleep will carry me, I will just feel hand like this. Somebody touch me. My daughter, wake up. I want to give you a message. I will just wake up. If I wake up, he will say, write. I will start writing again. Writing again. So by then, God opened my eyes. He gave me a message about tithe twice. Twice. He opened my eyes. As he opened my eyes, he showed me one evangelist. As he showed me the evangelist, he showed me his house. On that Sunday, they don't have anything to eat in their house. Nothing to eat. Then God says, you look, this man, he is my servant. He is my servant, but they don't have anything to eat. Then by then God says, we don't give. We don't give. We don't give. I felt it deep within me. I said, I am one of them. So, God says, give, it shall be given unto you. Then, I say, oh God, what will I do now? He said, okay, my daughter, watch. You will see what I will do. I keep on watching. The woman that we are together with her, I say, Mama, look at this house. She said, I am not seeing the house. Then, I realized, oh, it's between me and God. Then God says, I will use one party to provide their needs. Praise the Lord. As I am watching, God use one man and provide their needs. He brings food for them. Then God says, you see the reason why I say tithe is for the priest? Something that is theirs, you deny them and you did not take care of them. How? Why? What do you want them to do? Then I say, God, I will take it all. I will tell them. So on that morning, God opened my eyes again. He showed me that there was accident on our way. We prayed that night. We prayed. And God calmed the situation. On that Sunday, God visited us. Honestly, He visited us. As we finished for the program on that Sunday, we finished everything. We come to our side so that we just take our leave to Kaduna. So by then, on our way going, God say, my daughter, pick your writing materials again. I want to give you a message for Kaduna people. I say again, I just pick the pen. I started writing again, the same writing. But God says, I should tell to UMC and Kaduna, you should be very careful. That's what God tells me. Then I pass it to them. By then, I saw our car. It will crash like this. Then God says, keep your book. I will show you something on this road. Then I carried the book. I kept it aside. By then, as we started moving. Then God says, I will use you. You will be the driver. But I am the God that will be directing. Then God, get me the direction of the driver. As I come by, I want to sit at the other side. Then God said, no, sit down at the back of the driver. Then I sat down at the back of the driver. As we are moving. Oh, my dear brother, we should be praying for travelers. And then being God will open your eyes to see things on the road. Oh my God, praise the Lord. Then, as we start going, God is giving me direction. Tell driver to do this, to follow this way. If I say driver stop, the driver will stop. If I say driver move, the driver will move. I say, ha, this God is wonderful. As we entered Kaduna, then God said, my daughter, I will show you something. Then God opened my eyes. As He opened my eyes, I saw blood everywhere. Then I said, wow, on that Sunday, terrible fight wants to happen on that Sunday. But God calms the situation. He said, my daughter, I have promised you that I will take you back successfully. So I will fulfill my promise. Then we started praising God in the car. We reached one place. You see, like the fight will start it with us, but God will say, no, tell the driver, move. If I say driver, will just move. We reach one place, they just want to stop us. Then God say, no, tell driver to move forward. Driver, he moved. That's how God started doing his things. We reach to Kaduna. Then he say, El Rufai, 3 times. He didn't say anything. Praise the Lord. He didn't say anything. As we keep on going, then God say, I will show you something again. Then God opened my eyes. The drivers that they carry us, they were Boko Haram, all of them. They were Boko Haram. Then I say, wow, what is happening? The conductor is still a Boko Haram. He is looking for a way that the fight will start with us. But God says no. They are just saying, I'm just altering words. They are wondering how this woman comes to know that we are Boko Haram. So he wants to turn and see my eyes. He couldn't. If he wants to see my eyes, he couldn't. So I said no. God says I should tell him, you will not see my eyes until we reach. As we continue moving, then God ministers to me again, says, the big driver, he was a Boko Haram before, but now he has repented. He said, I will not shed a blood again. But the conductor, he is still a Boko Haram. So I started praying in my heart. I said, God, arrest those people. Arrest them. Arrest them. Then God says, my dear daughter, I will arrest them. Both of them, they will be a Christian. Praise the Lord. As we reach our junction, then God says, go to them and preach to them. As we reach, they were just wondering, they are shivering, how this woman knows that we are Boko Haram. Then I call them, I hold their hands, both of them. We go one side. I say, all of you are Boko Haram. They just stand. They didn't say anything. They didn't alter anyone. They are just looking themselves. If this one looks this one will look this one. How this one? And God is ministering to me that they are wondering, how did I know that they are Boko Haram? Then I say, God says, tell them, this God that you are refusing, this Isa the Mariama, is the real God, is the real Son of God. So accept him so that he will be your partner, Savior. I minister it to them. I tell them about God. I talk to them. They are just wondering. They didn't say anything. The only thing that they will say, Ma, we thank you. As I finished, I saw my husband is coming. As I saw him coming, I know that he was sent by God. Then he said, Mommy, since you have already passed the message, leave the remaining for God. Then God ministered to me that they will come. They will accept me. They will be my worker. Then I said, Lord, I give you all that work. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. That is how I have this encounter with God. All that is written here is true. Because I told Daddy everything. I am not good in speaking. I am not good in speaking, but I narrated everything. I narrated everything. So my dear brother and sister, hold this God. This man is a real man of God. Is the real man of God. He is called. He is called. When you respect him, you are respecting God. When you respect him, you are respecting God. So I believe, as my daddy said, as my daddy Alpha said, we will not find it easy. That's the plain truth. We will not find it easy. Because some people are saying, I am a witch, I am a occultist. Different kind of words. The other woman that I gave her the message, she said, she wants to kill me for the second time so that I will go and tell God the message that he has given me to her is not her own message. So she decided to kill me back face to face talk. Then I said, God, have mercy on her because I know she's not the one speaking. She's not the one speaking. So my dear brothers and sisters, hold this holiness tight. Hold it. Without holiness, no one can see the Lord. So may God bless us. Daddy, I have nothing to say. I have nothing. May God bless you. May God increase you the more. May God give you wisdom. Wisdom and wisdom and wisdom and wisdom. He returns back. May God bless you. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. I have forgotten. This is the writing. This is the writing that I wrote. This is the writing. This is the writing. This is the writing.
I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel. To follow Jesus Christ.
I want to be like Daniel.
Daniel. He was the man of holiness. He was full of wisdom. I want to be like Daniel to follow Jesus Christ. Daniel, I want to be like Daniel.
I want to be like Daniel to follow Jesus Christ.
He was full of wisdom, he was full of knowledge. I want to be like Daniel to follow Jesus Christ.
I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel to follow Jesus Christ.
I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel to follow Jesus Christ.
I want to be like Daniel.
Daniel, Daniel,
be like Daniel.
Amen. You can be seated. Now, I continue. I speak about the night vision and the interpretation. After our prayer and fasting, Tuesday 23rd May, that night, the Lord gave the following vision. It was like people assembled together in a church auditorium. A blackboard, was set before the people, having the unreadable writing or message Jesus gave to the sister for the Methodist church pasted on it. I want to say here, the message is to Methodist church, not just United Methodist Church. Amen. Methodist church. People were wondering how someone could read this writing and bring out the message. At this point, I, Pastor Paul Ricker, came and began to read the writing and make the message known to the people. The writing looked like Arabic Hebrew writing to the people. I began by saying, the word of God says, I rebuke the Methodist church. You are out of my way. I am about to spew you out of my mouth. Revelation chapter 3, verse 15 to 20. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear. And anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him. I will sup with him and he with me. I hear the sound of your worship, but I cannot see through to those worshiping. This is because you are covered with darkness of sin and evil. Matthew 15:7-9. Yea, hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you, saying, these people draweth near unto me with their mouth, and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. But in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. Methodists, you are full of pride. If you really want to recover from your spiritual bankruptcy and wretchedness, I counsel you to associate yourselves with Holiness Revival Movement worldwide, where you will learn my true word for your righteousness and holiness. Don't look down on Holiness Revival Movement worldwide, HORIMO. I raise this ministry up, this end time, as a spiritual guide for all churches in the world. Many of your members who have died came to realize this too late for themselves. If you refuse to humble yourselves, to obey my instruction, your members alive today will also come to realize this when it is too late for them. I decided to give this message to you at the grassroots and not to your top leaders, because they have left my way and gone into various sins. Methodists, the sin of adultery, fornication, idolatry, witchcraft, drunkenness, Freemasonry, occultism, covetousness, homosexuality, lesbianism, and such like is smelling among you. Galatians chapter 5, verse 19 to 21. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I've also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Repent of your sins, lest I spew you out of my mouth. Know that when I came to the world as a human being, I went to the common people, not to the Pharisees, the scribes, and Sadducees, who were the corrupt leaders of the people, full of vainglory. The reason I did not relate this to my daughter in plain language, but put it in unknown writing to her, is because she is not holy before God. She and her husband have faults in their lives which they have to settle with me. Their walk is not perfect before me. They will not have the boldness to declare this word fully to you due to fear of accusation and condemnation from others. This shows you the kinds of pastors you have over you. I have directed the writing to Pastor Paul Ricker as the only one in the world to read and make the message known to you. This is not for his pride, but to let you know that I have chosen him.
to make you and others in the churches know my word of truth, righteousness and holiness in this end time of backsliding and darkness in the churches. Acts chapter 9 verse 15. But the Lord said unto me, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. Jeremiah chapter 3 verse 15. And I will give you pastors according to my heart, who shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. End of interpretation. Pastor Paul Rica, can we honor God, worship him? Worship the Lord. Worship the Lord. Worship the Lord. Worship the Lord. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. Beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole earth. Is Mount Zion the site of the north, the city of the great king? Is Mount Zion site of the north, the city of the great? Hallelujah. Great. Hallelujah. We can be seated. Sister Bester, you can come up again and answer a question. In the mystery writing, in the interpretation presented, the Lord says, the reason why he gave the message in this mystery writing was because you and your husband were not holy. What do you tell the audience about this?
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. This one is true. It's true. Because I have confessed it to Daddy, but I will say it. I don't care. I don't care, but I don't want to need help. Praise the Lord. This question, before we go to Daddy, as I saw it, I said, Daddy, it's true. There is nothing that is hidden before God. Nothing is hidden before God.
Amen. Now, my observation. Thanks to God for this interpretation. He revealed in a night vision. The Lord had told Bester, according to what she said, that I am going to go before you to Pastor Rica. It's a mystery. You know, this is new. How it was done? Really, the Lord gave the interpretation before I even saw the writing. They came when the interpretation was already ready. The Lord said, I will go before you. Ah, this is mystery. Thank him again, please. Amen. You can sit down.
My observation, thanks to God for this interpretation he revealed in a night vision. I, Pastor Paul Rica, added the scripture quotations to make the message clearer and show how scriptural it is. The Lord be honored in Methodist Church and in all churches worldwide by this mystery. This great church was founded by John Wesley, whom the Lord used to pioneer holiness movement in the world in the 18th century. It was founded on biblical truth and redeemed many in the world and purified many believers in the churches. By his lifestyle and teaching, many made it to heaven. John Wesley taught holiness of heart through a definite experience of sanctification in the heart of a believer, which is required to cleanse him from inbred sin, Adamic nature, or inward depravity, in order to render the heart holy and undefiled before God. I have always made sanctification simple for your understanding by saying salvation is washing a dirty cloth. Sanctification is rinsing the washed cloth. Amen? Both are two different processes. Are they two different processes? Yes. Both are two different processes. In salvation, the dirty cloth is washed. But you know that if you just wash a dirty cloth and sun it, although it is looking clean, but it will be dull, there may be some line of dirt there. You then have to take it back for rinsing. That is sanctification. So these questions, these troubles are happening in your life as a believer already. Go back to God for sanctification. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might cleanse and sanctify it by the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself, a glorious church, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So go back for a second experience, sanctification. Then there is the third experience, baptism in the Holy Spirit. You wash the dirty cloth, you rinse it, then what's the next process after you have dried it? You iron it for use. The ironing is for use, so that it can look smart. Is that clear? That is baptism in the Holy Spirit. You don't go to heaven because you are baptized with the Holy Ghost. No, you go to heaven because you are morally clean. You are saved. Your heart is purified. You are sanctified. You are holy. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Now, I continue. He taught holiness of heart through a definite experience of sanctification in the heart of a believer, which is required to cleanse him from inbred sin, Adamic nature, or inward depravity, in order to render the heart holy and undefiled before God. He did not only emphasize on inward holiness, he also taught outward holiness, which involves the removal of ungodly clothing and adornment for total conformity to the holiness of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Removal of jewelry. Jewelry includes earrings, rings, nose rings, wedding ring, bracelet, necklace, beads, and all items of ornamentation. It is a biblical command to Christian women
Christian women should have proper head covering when praying or in worship service. As we see in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3 to 6, palming, jericoele, hair attachment, withal, wool in hair plating is condemned in scripture. Also, cortex, lipstick, painting of the body, bleaching, keeping of long nails, painting of nails, artificial eyelashes, use of short skirts or gown, body hearts, deep cut dresses, use of trousers, also called pants or slacks by women, use of see-through dresses, high heel shoes, dresses with shining stones, and such like are condemned as promiscuous and the dressing of harlots by the scripture. Revelation chapter 17, verse 1 to 6. In Proverbs chapter 7, verse 10, and behold, there met him a woman with the attire of an harlot and subtle of heart. But the enemy has badly affected John Wesley's work. All the Methodist churches of various names are far away from the teachings of John Wesley today. Now, youths in the church dress with fagging, do evil haircuts, wear earrings, put on tight-fitting clothes without rebuke in the church. Note also that divorce and remarriage, when the marriage partner, man or woman, is still alive, is a sin to God. Romans chapter 7, verse 2 and 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10 and 11. The fear of God has failed in many congregations. Holiness revival movement worldwide. In our day, the Lord himself has raised up holiness revival movement worldwide, non-denominational, under the leadership of my humble self, Pastor Paul Ricker, the international director, to restore truth, righteousness, and holiness back to his church. Through holiness revival movement worldwide, many sinners are being brought to the Lord and believers sanctified and made holy worldwide. It is a fast-growing non-denominational ministry which has covered about 35 nations of the world as at the time of this writing. Amen. Amen. The sign of his coming. This is one of the signs of the Lord's soon return, the mystery writing. Believe this, it is not man-made. It is a message to all churches. The Lord of the church is rebuking all lukewarm and backsliding churches and is calling them to repentance and holiness. The preachers must repent of their sins and preach the true gospel message of repentance, righteousness, and holiness to prepare the members for the rapture soonest. Members of backsliding churches who reject God's holiness and warning must allow God to lead them to his truth, holiness, righteousness, for their spiritual fitness and readiness for the rapture. In case you are in some of these churches and they reject this message, they reject this God's truth, God's revelations, the message of holiness, righteousness, the truth explained in scripture, confirmed by many revelations, well, you are not sold to that congregation. It's not the church that will give account of itself, but you, every man, shall give account of himself, account of ourselves before God. Be wise, turn off from the congregation of the dead that are fighting truth, fighting the lie. And the Bible says, flee youthful lusts, but follow righteousness, truth, charity, faith, with them that call upon the Lord out of a pure heart. For your soul, in Hebrews chapter 12 verse 14, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. In 1 John chapter 3 verse 2 and 3, beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And everyone that hath this hope in him purifieth himself even as he is pure. And to the members of Holiness Revival Movement, see what your God is doing to confirm your stand that you are being persecuted by some churches, even some so-called holiness churches. I put so-called there because they should have known that here, this is where Jesus is walking. And when the disciples told Jesus, we saw some two people casting out demons in your name and we forbade them, what did the Lord say? Forbid them not. He that is not against us is for us. Then if you are a holiness church and we are preaching Christ's holiness, people are changing, where is it moving you to envy? Why are you persecuting us? Are we not the children of the same God? Then something is wrong with you. Something is wrong with you, because it is the carnal that persecutes the spiritual. You have gone carnal, that's why you're doing what you're doing. You have gone carnal. Else, they that love thee shall be glad when they see me, because I am called after your name. That's what the psalmist said. You have been so happy that, oh, thank God, the Lord has visited these other people also. The disciples were happy when Peter clearly testified to them what the Lord was doing among the Gentiles. Were they not glad? We are glad, for the Lord has visited the Gentiles also. We are one. But for you to be moved with envy and pride, you have fallen off from the grace of God. It's a clear evidence. And now you, don't mind the persecution. Stand fast in righteousness and holiness. Promote holiness revival movement. For the Lord to come up and say, nobody in the world can interpret this message but the International Director of Holiness Revival Movement, Pastor Paul Ricker. What do you think God has in his mind? He wants to let the world know of Holiness Revival Movement. Is that so? If God is advertising Holiness Revival Movement, are you not going to advertise it? Support God to advertise this. Get more of this thing printed and start circulating them. Amen. If you are ready to do so, see your coordinators and let's know you. Let the world be filled with this. For God is the one that brought it to advertise his movement. In fact, it's advertisement of himself. If God is lifting up any man, it's because the man is bearing him. And as the man is going higher, he's carrying God higher. So it is promoting himself. No man is taking the glory. Praise the Lord. Now, the Lord gave our sister a vision of a man of God. I don't know which church the man of God belonged to. The man was not well cared for. He was suffering, walking and suffering. And he must have belonged to an organization where they are paying tithes. And this tithes, of course, is bring ye this tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. So that people who are working should have food to eat. But there are many churches who are more interested in material development, buying cars, building cathedrals, than in providing money to the workers who are bringing souls to God. A building, well built, can be pulled down by the devil, can be pulled down in war, during war. But a soul saved, even if he dies, goes to heaven.
So what about those who are ministering to these people? They should be cared for. Is that clear? But the Bible says, bring ye the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be what? Meat in my house. That there should be money in my house. What does the Bible say of money? Money answered all things. The money that has come into my house answers all things. The poor can be taken care of. The widows can be assisted from the same money in the storehouse. Is that clear? Gospel programs can be sponsored by the same with the same money in the storehouse. Projects can be undertaken to the glory of the Lord with the same money in the storehouse. I have to say this because some will think, as the Lord is saying, tithes are to take care of the ministers. A person can sit over tithes. A big church like this, if all the tithes should belong to this small man standing here, you will spoil him. You get it now. What will he do with it? Will he go and build the world? To do what again? The money is for the Lord. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine. So let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. While it is said the tithe should be used to minister to the ministers, it doesn't mean all that money should go to one man. No. There are other workers there. The church has security men. The church has administrators. The church has drivers. The church has this. All of them benefit from what? From the tithes. So the tithes, therefore, come to pay, to be used to pay salary. And of course, buying seats in the church, building a church auditorium. It's only while you do this, don't muzzle the mouth of the ox that treaded the corn. Don't neglect the ministers who are ministering for the Lord. The Bible says, especially they that minister in the word and in doctrine. Make sure from this time you're also helping them. You're taking care of them. That's what God desires. Let all things be done decently and in order. So let no pastor go and carry all the money. That will be covetousness. If it's a small church, well, the behavior, how money is used in a small church is different from how it is used in a big church. Why? The money is small. At that time, much of it goes to the minister to take care. But when the money becomes big, the minister has his own portion. Other portions also go for other things in the house of God. Hallelujah! How the Lord has done it. That's also wonder Jesus they do. I say, that's also miracles Jesus they do. Yes, he has done it. Yes, yes, yes. He has done it for us. Now throw some miracles Jesus is doing. Now throw some miracles Jesus is doing. He has done it for us. Yeah,
has done it for us. He has opened our eyes, we have seen it ourselves. He has voted this of Daniel to our midst now. Hey, hey, he has done it for us. Yes. Amen. The Lord led us to fasting today because today is going to be the day of wisdom. You are going to receive the gift of wisdom and understanding. Just as our sister Bester said, when her pastor, our beloved pastor, attended the conference, Holiness Revival Movement Conference in Kwali, a new spirit took over him. Amen? A new spirit? A new spirit will take over you today. Open your mouth and make requests. A new spirit of understanding, knowledge and wisdom, hallelujah, is coming upon your life today. You will understand, you will see the visions of the Lord. God will give you an understanding heart. God will give you an understanding heart. Name we pray. Now, actually, your life has not been with God before, or you were a Christian and you backslid. With this now, you say, what am I waiting for? I'm coming back to Jesus. I'm giving my life to Jesus and I repent of my sins. My life will change from now. I decide from today to be a new creature. Can you raise up your hand? I want to pray for you. I have decided. Raise up that hand this well. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. Not turning back. Not turning back. Never turning back. Yes, I have decided. I have decided.
To
Raise up your hand, I'm praying for you. You have the, who have decided. Confess your sins and tell the Lord you repent of them. Tell Jesus to come into your heart and take over your life. That you are making a promise, you will follow him now. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, let your spirit come upon your children. Lord, accept them. Accept them. God, forgive them. Lord, take over their lives. Take over their lives. Change them by your power. Let them become children of God. Let them become children of God. Thank you, Jesus. Let them become children of God. Jesus' name we pray. Almighty Father, these ones that raised up their hands to receive you, may the Lord come upon them, come into them now in Jesus' name. I pray you will forgive their sins. You will give them the new life in Jesus' name. The spirit of righteousness, the spirit of truth will enter and take possession of their life in Jesus' name. My God, all involvement with the devil, I destroy completely. Any way the devil has inhabited them, God, I drive him away from their life. Deliver them in Jesus' name. Set them free, my Father. Give them the joy of the new life. In Jesus' name we pray. Now, wisdom is time now for wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. You want, just raise up that thing given to you. That paper is the writing of wisdom. Oh Lord, I want to be like Daniel. 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 He was a man of holiness. He was full of wisdom. You need to be like Daniel to follow Jesus Christ.
I want to be like
Daniel.
I want to be like Daniel. I want to be like Daniel to follow Jesus Christ.
Now, tell God like that. Tell God. Give me this wisdom. I want to be a holy man. I want to be a righteous man. I want to be a holy man. I need wisdom and understanding in the Word of God. Wisdom of the Word of God. Wisdom of the Christian life. Oh Lord, give it to me. Oh Lord, give it to me. He was a man of wisdom. Jesus, give me wisdom to serve you. Wisdom is the principal thing. Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom in all thy getting. Get understanding. Ask the Lord, he that lacketh wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth unto all men liberally and upbraideth not, it shall be given him.
Jesus' name we pray. Almighty Father, you choose to visit our day with your wisdom. Lord, it is not only for one man. What you have done for one, you will do for others. Here are my brethren. I am asking that heaven will open. The spirit of wisdom will descend upon every one of them in Jesus' name. May they understand the mind of the Lord. May they understand the handwritings of the Lord. May they understand the deep sayings of God. May they understand the revelations of God. May they understand the truth of God. May they, O Lord, be enlarged in heart concerning your righteousness, your holiness, in Jesus' name. My God, let anointing fall upon them. Let them be vessels unto honor. Holy Ghost, come upon your people. Holy Ghost, take over your people. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Child of God, receive the wisdom of God, the power of God, the gift of knowledge, the word and the gift of understanding. Receive it. In the name of Jesus, may the Lord enlarge your life. May the Lord enlarge your understanding. May the Lord do exploit through your life. May the Lord make the mystery of the kingdom known through you. In the name of Jesus. The power of the Lord, the wisdom of the Lord has come on you. You will be another man. You will be another woman. Thank you, Jesus. Tell him thank you. Tell him thank you. I want to invite the Methodist church pastor, our beloved Pastor Hockey Alpha, and then his wife and beloved sister Besta. They are coming in so we can pray for them. We're going to pray for them. It is God that has come to them for ministry. Where is the wife of Pastor Hockey? Pastor Alpha. Please join them. It's God that has manifested himself to promote their work. We're going to ask that the Lord Most High will use them all. Lift them up before the Lord. Jesus' name we pray.
You can sit down. Now, I give you people charge. The God you are serving in Methodist Church is not a denominational God. What the Lord has decided to use your church to do, a branch of Methodist Church, is not for your church or for yourself only, but for the whole world. Don't respect elders. Don't respect bishops. And deny the Lord the privilege to use you. If you do so, none will be saved in that place. But if you stand boldly, many will be saved, including some of them. Don't mind the present persecution. The Pharisees persecuted Jesus. But eventually, after the death of Christ and his resurrection, some of them also believed in Christ. So, be bold. Fear nobody. If they say they don't want you in Methodist Church again, in United Methodist Church, believers want you everywhere. For Jesus is the honor of the whole world. Now, Sister Alpha, give it to Sister Alpha. Did you repent after the events that you didn't give Sister Bester the writing material and the pen to write? Did you tell God you are sorry?
Yes, I have done that.
You have done that?
Yes, sir. I met her. I told her that although we are told that I should not give her because there was a pastor that came. He now told us that we should just allow her to be saying what, that we should not give her the written material. That's why we did not give her.
Why did the pastor say so?
Because we are thinking that maybe her blood was so high. Without knowing that the Lord is trying to do something.
Praise the Lord. Have we also forgiven her?
Yes.
The Church of God has also forgiven you.
Thank you, sir. I'm here. I want to still ask for forgiveness because I don't know that's how it's going to happen. But God knows why it happens like that. Therefore, I'm here asking for forgiveness for what I've done. I'm asking that may the Lord Almighty God forgive me in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Everybody say you are forgiven. Thank you. Go and sit down. Amen. Now, the message you have just listened to is a production of Holiness Revival Movement Worldwide. Holiness Revival Movement Worldwide is a non-denominational ministry that is given to the propagation of Christ's righteousness and holiness in churches and nations of the world through crusades, revival meetings, production and spread of holiness literature and materials. For other spiritual materials, messages, or inquiries, contact us on 0816-902-3948 or 0805-683-4323. You can also reach us through our email address, holinessrevivalmovement@gmail.com. God bless you.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Hallelujah.
Jesus, I believe. You are my Lord and Savior. I believe in you. heaven. You died for my sins. You purchased me with your blood. You are my Lord and my Savior.
Jesus, I believe.
I believe in you. You are the living Savior. I believe in you. I love you, Lord.
I love you.
I believe.
I believe.